And that jarring cacophony, which is getting a little bit disco there in the background with the Mankind version of the Doctor Who theme, tells you it's the 1970s and it's also 2024. You're listening to the Power of Three podcast and I'm Kenny Smith and I'm joined today by the one and only...
Stephen Day. Hi, Kenny, for episode 201.
Yeah, it's scary. I mean, it seems just like a few minutes since we're doing episode 200, but 7 days have passed and here we are.
Yeah, there was an awful lot of clearing up of bottles of Iron Brew and Tunnock's caramel wafers and stuff.
Yep, sweeping up the studio, just the two of us. And But I think then again, I suppose once we finished recording, when the other guys came round, when Tom and Dave and John came round.
I can't believe how loud they were and what they brought.
Thank God the microphone wasn't on when Tom was giving us his views on Doctor Who these days. Yeah. We'd have been cancelled.
The beep machine might have been, overawed.
Absolutely. It would have been broken, I think. So, yes. But there we go. Our 200th episode's done. So now we're closing in on episode 300. Only after today, 99 more to go. So I'm sure we'll achieve that probably by, given the rate at which episodes are coming out at the moment, we'll probably achieve that by July. No, I jest.
I was going to say Easter, but maybe that's...
Okay, yeah. Okay, well, maybe push back on that a little bit. So, yes, we're continuing our look at season 15 on Blu-ray, which is on the way and will be out in, as we speak, just over 2 weeks. So, quite exciting. And I do love my Doctor Who, the collection. I've got my set so far, and there's just something so lovely about having a whole Doctor Who series on a shelf and just in one big box, like the thickness of like a videotape and a half.
Do you know the great thing about having physical media? Now, I know there's been enhancements and effects, but the fact is, with physical media, nobody can change it. If you buy season 15 or all the stories in season 15 10 years ago, you can go to your player, pop them in, and they'll be exactly the same. You buy your season 15 new stuff, and you get all the enhancements and everything, but it's there, and pop it in. Nobody can say, oh, do you know, that scene was maybe a bit more underrepresentative. I think we'll change it.
Yeah,
that's what I love about real media.
Yes, I'm the same. That's why I still like to buy books. I like to buy newspapers. I like to buy CDs. I'm very, very 20th century.
It's not 20th century. It's keeping an archive.
Or is it called being normal?
Normal, yes, normal.
Yeah, hear that one, 21st century kiddos, buy real things, support them, buy magazines, buy books, and don't pirate them because we don't approve of that in the slightest.
No.
So there, piracy costs money.
It does, jobs and lives.
Exactly, particularly in the media. So buy a magazine, buy a newspaper, buy a book. Subscribe to them all as well. So yes, don't subscribe to like every magazine and newspaper because that would just bankrupt you.
That's too much.
Subscribe to ones that you like. Buy Doctor Magazine, buy SFX, buy these things. Give them money. Don't just wait on Twitter for somebody to share all the news for free. Not good. And if you do that, then Dave Steele will come around and he'll break your knees.
We have such lovely company, don't we?
We do. We do indeed. So let's stop talking about breaking knees and doing horrific things to people because we'll leave that to the Fendahl. So let's have a very quick clip from Image of the Fendahl.
There's someone coming. Clear it. Someone coming.
Your discovery could be one of the most important milestones in human development.
Fendahl.
Is it alive?
Yes.
Adam.
I said, don't touch her.
The
are 4,000 million people here on your planet. And if I'm right, within a year, there'll be just one left alive.
The place must be left for the one that kills.
It grows and exists by death.
This is not how it should be!
You are being used! Mankind has been used!
So, yes, now, you mentioned last week, Stevie, that Image of the Fendahl was a story that isn't particularly one that you enjoyed.
Not particularly. I read it first, I think, and then I watched it. This would probably be my second watching the other week.
Yep.
And I think the fact that I forgot it existed when you mentioned it before in this season is probably indicates something. It was a fair enough book-ish, but wasn't one of my highlights. I don't know, I felt it was just lacking something. I can see it, as I said, as a wee bit of a feeder for K-9 and Company with the witchcraft and things, and if you're into that, it's all good. But yeah, I don't know. It was just one of those slower stories. I loved the little baby Fendahl. I felt very sorry for that. There were an awful lot of coincidences, but maybe not properly explained. Am I misinterpreting something? Was the priory was destroyed, wasn't it?
Yes. Fetch Priory, yeah.
Did we have something built on that later?
No, I think you're thinking of it was Pyramids of Mars, you're right. It was the same building.
It was the same building.
Mick Jagger's old house. And Unit HQ was built on top of the house from Pyramids of Mars.
Right, so not the image of the Fendahl, so I'm getting confused.
It is the same building, but that's why you're getting confused. It's exactly the same building, but used two seasons apart. So, yeah, that's interesting to say that, because for me, Fendahl is one of those ones. It's, again, it feels like horror Fang Rock. It could almost be a final hurrah for the era that went before. It's got, you know, the trademarks of the Hinchcliffe Holmes style, where you've got a story that feels like it's based on a Hammer horror film. It's got that kind of feel to it with scientists, almost a bit Quatermass in the Pit, that sort of way. And you've got the body horror with people being transformed into something else. And yeah, there's maybe it doesn't have much charm or fun to it.
Did you remember up what I was saying about horror fan rock? Horror Fang Rock last week was that you cared about the characters, even the guy who, you know, caused the ship to crash because he wanted to get back to London in the fog. But you know, you did care about the characters. I just felt with Fendahl, I didn't really care much or too much about the characters. Maybe it was a bit too wordy. Maybe it was a bit too slow. It's fine, you know. It's an adventure. I'm not going to trash it because it's a favourite of many and it's decent enough. Just doesn't grab me.
Interesting. Because I think the imagery is fantastic. I mean, you've got Benedict Cumberbatch's mum as the Fendahl Corps, Wanda Ventham. I think she's fantastic. And she looks incredible when she's in all the gold and all the spinning around. And just that's horrific, sort of the fact that she's been stripped of her individuality and become this monstrous thing that spins around and with her death stare. Yeah, and as Dave and I said a few weeks back, Benedict was about 1 year old when she did this. But I think she's fab. But yeah, the other characters are fairly sort of generic scientists with big moustaches and things like that.
Yeah, but fine. And, you know, Tom's doing the thing. I think, although there are many people going to be typing at their keyboards now, I think Granny, if I'm not wrong, was the mother in To the Manor Born.
Oh, I didn't know that. But I was thinking when you mentioned Granny, could she be great-grandmother to Rose Tyler, since it's the Tyler family?
There's a big finish in that.
There is.
But anyway, I'd be interested to know if she was William Devere's mother from To the Manor Born. She just had that look about her, and it was probably about the right time. Mm-hmm. I haven't done my research. I'm sorry, people out there. Somebody can tell me on the YouTube channel and just drop us a video and tell us.
Yeah, and we'll drop that in next week. But, I mean, what do you think of the design of the Fendahl?
Hair seemed to feature in this season, as I said before. Mm-hmm. It was fairly immobile for a creature that was going to cause problems. I loved baby Fendahl. I think I want one of them on my desk. I don't know.
Keep chatting, Stevie. I'm going to get something out of the cupboard.
Okay. The image that is on the front of the Target cover, you can imagine it as a monster. I think as it's revealed, it's just not what I was expecting. And listeners, you see me observing the back of Kenny as he goes into his natural habitat of storage. He's stalking now, gently looking on shelves. And there he comes. He's got his prey. And as he sits down, he's about to present what he has captured. Yes, he has captured... Oh, baby Fendahl.
Yeah, oh, it's the character options action figure. So it's very immobile, it's solid, but it looks good.
Well,
it looks really
good.
Do
you know, it was carrying on from the program. That's unfair. It's a prawn-based life form, I feel. I can see what they were aiming for.
Yeah, something sort of somewhere between snaky, insectoid, reptilian, just... But yeah, I mean, it's the action figure, you can get a bit more detail on it, and it is quite horrible, but yeah.
I think in the design, the original design of it, if you did that now and you were CGIing it, somebody back then was way ahead of the curve in what they want to design. But you, again, you're hampered by budget, how fast you can move it, what menace is actually going to cause. I mean, for me, the horror, as in most things in horror movies, is, you know, have a perfectly ordinary skull. Well, that's horror enough.
Yeah.
To make it start glowing is, you know, you don't want to be coming down a corridor in an old house in the dark and meet a glowing skull.
No, I would agree with that.
That's the horror. I feel a bit like Alien. Less of the Fendahl would have been more. Leave it up to my imagination.
Okay, there we go. Thank you for that, Stevie. Interesting.
What did you think, Kenny, though? I mean,
I enjoy it. I mean, it's because it's a story I like, but I don't love, because I think it's the sort of the humour, because I do like my Doctor Who with a bit of humour, and this one, it's quite grim, it's quite relentless, it's quite dark that way, and I mean, I think it's well directed by George Benton Foster, but there's just something about it. I don't quite know what it is. I can't quite put my finger on it to make me go from liking it to loving it.
Yeah. I think it's a pacing thing as well.
Yeah.
I think it could be maybe less words and just slightly tighter. If it had been a 3-episoder or a 2-episoder, maybe, I don't know. We will never know.
No, we won't. But something that we will know, Stevie, is a bit of detail about how this season was brought to life.
Mm-hmm.
We're now going to have a quick chat with Richard Bignell, who has, as always, created the PDF archive that appears on these discs. And he's got a hell of a lot of pages. I'm not going to tell you how many pages are on this. He's going to tell you himself, and let's hear from him now.
Hello, I'm Richard Bignell, and for the Blu-ray collections, I primarily look after the PDF archive and curating that, putting it all together.
So, Richard, as we stand today, we're talking on the 12th of January, the day after season 15 has been announced. How many pages do you currently have for this next release?
So this next one currently stands at 4,353. Pages. So it's sort of one of our middling ones. Didn't quite reach the heights of the season 20 with 8,800 odd, but that's perhaps only to be expected. But yeah, it's a decent size one this time.
And on what date will this finally be locked off, just in case you come across anything else? Because I know what you're like.
Well, theoretically, because the PDF archive doesn't have to go through the same vetting procedures as the video material does, theoretically we could make adjustments right up until the point where they press the button to say, right, it's all now being sent off, which we have done on occasions, and also when we go through the quality control test discs, Sometimes you'll suddenly spot things where you've not quite set things right, the parameters are slightly off, and you just have to make slight adjustments. So, you know, things are done at that stage as well. So it's not really too much of an issue to slot something else in if we need to. But it doesn't usually happen that late. Usually we try and get it all done and dusted in plenty of time.
Now, the thing that mentioned last time with season 20 was the fact there was such a surplus of material and you'd started work on it years ago. So when did you begin work on season 15?
Oh, gosh. Probably about 8 or 9 months ago, I would have thought, started doing it. As soon as I'm told what the forthcoming sets are, I will start work almost immediately, just in my own headspace, really, just working out, okay, what's available, what do we need to be looking for, and so on and so forth. So this week I have just been told what the set after the next one will be. I've already started compiling my list of what I need to look at the written archives, various bits and pieces I need to start looking for. In fact, I did my first PDF for it last night, so that's 53, 54 pages in the bag already.
When?
So it's you tend to start as soon as possible because a lot of the work that I do has got to go into the processing of the material once you've got it scanned. So you've got to go through it. A, can we use it? Do we need to get permissions to use it? If so, trying to secure that. If it's third-party material, if the people are still around. Any redactions that need to be made, manually need to be made. Any tidying up that needs to be done if it happens to be very old material. Some of the scripts we're now using can be quite old scans that have been done off of microfilm and stuff. So they can be a bit grubby, be a bit dirty. So you sort of sometimes sit there trying to tidy it up as much as possible, get things straight, trying to tidy up any of the marks that have appeared over the years where it's been copied off several times. So, you know, sometimes I was doing some of this over the break, and I think one front page of one script took me about half an hour to tidy up, you know, and some scripts you've got 70, 80 pages worth to do. So it's it can be a bit of a laborious process sometimes, but, you know, you're doing it once for a final result just to make something look as good as possible. So the sooner I can crack into it, the better it is for my own peace of mind that's been done, and I can go on to other materials. It, you know, you don't feel like you're chasing too much right towards the end of the process to try and cram everything in.
So you previously teased us with some gems in advance. So what particular highlights have you found in these old scripts, letters, and other documents?
There's some nice bits and pieces coming up in season 15. So for Horror of Fang Rock, we have the one episode synopsis that Terrence Dix did. I think after they swapped over from the Vampire Mutations and they weren't doing that anymore, and he was going to go over to doing a Lighthouse story, he did a very brief synopsis of the first episode of Rocks of Doom, as it was called at the time. Just to show where the thing was going. So that's a single page document, but you've got a different set of characters in there than the ones we've ended up with. So your lighthouse keepers, you've still got Ben, as we have now, but the other two were originally Joshua and Davy. Lord Palmerdale was originally Lord Peach Palmer, with a hyphen, and he's got still got Adelaide, his secretary, but he's also got a valet called Birkin. And Skinsell has his wife with him, Veronica, in that. So it's a slightly different character makeup that they've got. We've also got, for horror fang rock, there are the visual effects storyboards, which were drawn up. We've also got Mitch Mitchell's video effects storyboards and plans that he made at the time. So we've got that. There's rather an interesting letter towards the end, which actually comes from Graham Williams to Sean Caffrey, who played Palmerdale. And it's one that I've not really seen before and not seen talked about, because apparently Sean Caffrey, very last day of recording, decided to throw a complete wobbler on the studio floor. And Graham Williams is basically ticking him off for his attitude and the way he went about things, and said, you know, I'm trying to effectively say to you, this isn't professional, you shouldn't be doing this, and I'm trying to address this with you directly, because if I did it through your agent, it will be in rather more stronger terms. We don't exactly know what happened and what went wrong. There's certainly never reply to it. But yeah, so it adds an interesting bit of colour into horror fang rock. Invisible Enemy, there's a little piece of documentation in there to say that very early on, director Derek Goodwin had pulled Fantastic Voyage out of the archive to have a look at, so that he could get some inspiration in doing that. There's a number of memos in there relating to K9 and the fact that BBC Enterprises were going to give £500 towards the development of K9 because they wanted it, in their words, to ensure that it had merchandising potential. But then there's a few back and forth to that when they find out that Bob Baker and Dave Martin do have rights in K9, and therefore any money that BBC Enterprises get back might end up having to be split with them, and they're not overly chuffed with that. We've got a separate little, in connection with Invisible Enemy, we've got a separate little PDF archive for K9's appearance on Blue Peter, that famous one that he does with John Noakes and Shep going a bit mad.
Yep.
And what's quite nice in that is that it's Graham Williams who actually writes the script for that. And you actually see in that just how well scripted Blue Peter actually was, because what Graham Williams writes is pretty much verbatim what they actually did on the day. So that's sort of quite interesting from that point of view. And Biddy Baxter was so delighted with that she actually asked Graham whether or not it would be okay from their point to go and do to show viewers how to make their own K9 on Blue Peter, which they never actually did. That was something that they never went through with, but they were asking the question. Graham Williams didn't seem to have a problem with it. So, yeah, that's something that they didn't do. Image of the Fendahl. There's a rather nice list in there of potential actors that they were going to look at for Dr. Fendelman. So we've got people like Michael Goff, Colin Blakely. Interestingly, Michael Bryant, who was the Michael Bryant who was on The Stone Tape, played the lead in The Stone Tape. Shouty Michael Bryant. Yes. Now, that could have been quite an interesting bit of casting. John Carson, who, of course, ends up in Snake Dance. The well-known stage actor Paul Damon. Alfred Burke. Robert Hardy. Charles Kay. There's quite a few that they were considering as possible. So it's an interesting thought, an interesting take on Fendelman. There's also a nice memo in there from Graham McDonald, the head of Serials, after he's read the rehearsal script, because in the original rehearsal script, you do actually see Stahl killing himself by putting the gun in his mouth. And Graham McDonald says, I don't really think that's on. That's a bit heavy. And indeed, Graham Williams, in his response to that, says, yes, we've already flagged that, and we've already come up with an alternate for that we're doing. But one of the nice things with this particular set is that we do have, as well as the camera scripts for Image of the Fendahl, we do have the rehearsal scripts as well, which have been donated to us by a collector. Mark Watterson, he got Chris Boucher's original rehearsal scripts, and he's allowed us to scan those and include those on the set. So you've actually got on there, you can actually see the passage that Graham Donald was looking at, where it talks about Stahl raising the gun to his mouth to sort of blow his head off. So you can actually see the reasons why Graham Donald was a bit twitchy about it. For those of you who were listening when we did covered season 20 a few months ago, I made reference on there to some photographs which we were had managed to find. Well, this is where they come in, because I got in contact with the designer Anna Ridley on an image of the Fendahl. It's the only one that Anna ever did for Doctor Who, and I got in contact with her just to say, look, you know, do you happen to have kept any of your drawings or studio layouts or anything for the program? And she hadn't, but she did come back and say, well, I do have a set of slides that I took during the studio rehearsals, and you're welcome to use those if you want. So she sent us those. I think there's about 19 or so slides in total. So I sent those off to Derek Handley. Derek scanned those in HD. So we've got a nice section on the photo gallery, which is all of Anna's photographs, which are lovely. And yeah, we thank Anna very much for those as well. Underworld was actually a surprisingly thin file, production file, when we got to it. It mainly consists of copious amounts of, perhaps unsurprisingly, Mitch Mitchell's video effects storyboards, trying to work out how on earth they were going to do the majority of those cave scenes. So we include all of those, as well as the few bits of documentation. Invasion of Time is an interesting one. There's quite a lot of documentation for Invasion of Time, but the actual document archive is 540 pages on Invasion of Time. That's got Graham Williams's storyline for the Invasion of Time, just showing how they originally envisioned it. We've got, as normal, the scripts, the camera scripts for this. Just to explain, though, that the camera scripts for these ones are something of a hybrid, because as far as we're aware, no full set of camera scripts is known to exist for these that are properly usable. The BBC's hard copy versions are very scrappy, and they are overwritten in biro, at least for episodes 1 to 4, maybe 2, 3, 4. 5 and 6 are okay, but they're usable. But what we had, we managed to find a set of studio recording scripts. So they are just the pages for those studio recording days, set by set. So we managed to find that. So we had some of the original pages that we could put back in. We then managed to find another studio recording, which had some of the missing pages in between those, which we were able to put in. And then I've had to infill those with copies of the BBC's microfilmed camera scripts. So it's a bit of a patchwork quilt, the six episodes. As I said, 5 and 6 are fine. I think 1's not too bad. 2, 3, and 4 are sort of various alternate sort of black and white and colour copies, depending on what you've got. We tried to get it as best as we can, but essentially what you end up with is the best set of camera scripts that you're likely to get available, unless they suddenly turn up from somewhere. What we have also included, though, is the BBC's hard copy scripts for Invasion of Time for episodes 2, 3, and 4 are all marked videogram edit. And this goes back, way back, if people can remember, in Doctor Who magazine's early years, to the, I think it was a Gallifrey, no, it wasn't, it was a Matrix data bank. And someone had written in asking if any, that their parents had just got a VHS player or something, VHS or video disc, can't remember. And was any Doctor Who going to be ever commercially available? And they came out with this one line of, oh, BBC Enterprises are thinking out about bringing a 90-minute edit of Invasion of Time out. And no more was ever said about it. And the assumption was that this was just a passing idea, that nothing happened. And indeed, that was my assumption up until about 10 years ago, when I happened to mention it I think on Gallifrey base. And then I pretty much immediately got an email through from Andrew Martin at the BBC archive saying, no, they actually did it. And it's sitting in the vault. They completed the edit and it's sitting in a vault. Now, of course, at that time, we couldn't do anything with it because the DVD range was coming to an end. We'd already done Invasion of Time and there was no real thought about doing anything further with them. But of course, when we started doing the Blu-rays, this obviously now became a possibility again. And I mentioned this to Paul Venizis, saying maybe we should have a look, see whether or not this actually is there, because Andrew had indicated that BBC Worldwide had a vault in the archives with some of their masters in, and it was part of that. Andrew said that he had gone to look for it and he couldn't find it at that particular moment, but he did know that it was there because he'd actually seen it at some point. So Paul passed this on to Steve Roberts, because Steve works at Paravel, at the archive, and Steve said, well, there isn't a vault for BBC Worldwide as it was material. And then he asked one of his bosses, and his bosses said, oh yeah, but there was, but it's no longer here. And a lot of the material had been put into deep storage, but they'd gone through it. They had gone through it and weeded it out. So quite a protracted period of time went past where checks were being made. The long and the short of it, it appears that the thing no longer exists. It has gone.
Oh.
But what we do have are these rather scrappy scripts, and these are the ones that have been photocopied, and then I think probably the BBC script unit, as it was then, went over them in blue biro to try and make them a bit more legible. And then for episodes 2, 3, and 4, we've got scrawled on the front videogram edit. And you go through the scripts and there are scenes actually physically crossed out as to what they were going to get rid of or what they were planning to get rid of. So I thought, well, for the sake of this, it would be nice just to put all of those together so that people I've not tidied them up in any way. They're just pretty much the raw scans as they've come out of the BBC archive. We did consider whether or not there was a possibility that we could remake it. And I did a very quick offline edit of it, literally just chopping out those scenes to see whether or not it would work. Now, DWM had said when they mentioned it that this was supposed to be a 90-minute edit. So effectively, you're losing a good chunk of the story, you know, about half of the story. Just chopping out the scenes in 2, 3, and 4. But because my assumption was that perhaps what they were aiming to do was to cut the Varden half of the story, those 4 episodes, down by half, and then effectively leave 5 and 6, which is the Sontaran half of the story, as complete as possible. So you had a Varden half and you had a Sontaran half.
That's what I'd do.
Because there weren't any edit scripts for 5 and 6. So I wondered if that was a possibility. If you just do the raw edit based on the scripts for 2, 3, and 4 and leave episode 1 pretty much intact, of course, you're taking out a lot of the credits, opening and closing credits as well. It takes for those 4 down to about 1 hour, 6 minutes. When you add on that extra 50 minutes of 5 and 6, that takes it over onto about 1 hour 55, which is still way over length if they were doing a 90-minute. So my assumption is they probably would have had to hack it down quite a bit more. It was noticeable that the edits that they were thinking about making were also partial scenes as well. So there are some horrific potential jump cuts in the scenes. And some very clunky ones as well, because there are cuts coming halfway through music. So I'm not quite sure how they would have tidied that up in the end if they were actually going to do it as a commercial project. But that was just an assumption of mine, that perhaps they would try to leave the first episode-ish complete, episodes 5 and 6 complete, and try and compress the rest down. It doesn't quite work like that in practice. So they would have had to have done more tidying. But yeah, so unfortunately, it looks like the work that was done on it by BBC Enterprises, BBC Worldwide, as they were at the time, doesn't exist anymore. But you can hopefully get a little bit of a flavour with it, with the hybrid scripts that the videogram edit scripts that they've actually put together. Yeah. So it might give people an idea of what's what.
So in terms of invasion of time there, was there much from Killer Cats or whatever Killer Cats was properly called to be included there? Because I know there were things like costume designs were started and things like that.
There was. Killers of the Dark is the proper title. I did actually speak to David Weir once about it, and he seemed to intimate that he actually got money for the whole for quite a bit of the concept of Gallifrey and stuff that he was developing, but he hadn't kept anything, unfortunately. I have included a few bits and pieces, so I've included material relating from David Weir's file relating to the commissioning of Killer Cats, but there's not really anything there as such about the story and what they would have done with it or how it would have developed. So there's a few bits and pieces there, but not a whole lot. But I've just included that extra bits of for Killer Cats, as I have done on Horror of Fang Rock. I've included some of that early material or early commissioning material for Vampire Mutations, which is obviously in the slot originally. So it just sort of adds a nice extra little bit of
I haven't mentioned the Sunmakers. Was there much from that of interest?
No. it's basically the fairly mundane production material that you get, but I don't think anything particularly stood out as far as the Sunmakers was concerned. I mean, it's a reasonable file, the Sunmakers. It's 272 pages that we got for that, but it's fairly run of the mill stuff for the Sunmakers. But I'm sure people will find some interest there. But we've also got some studio floor plans as well, which didn't come from the BBC. They came from Mitch Mitchell. So we're grateful to him for supplying those. So we've got one for Horror of Fang Rock, which Chris Chapman has used in his new feature about horror to do a CGI recreation of the studio, which is a very nice thing. We've got another one for Invisible Enemy, and we've got one for Underworld as well. So it's some extra material that's come from outside sources.
Ooh, exciting stuff. So aside from the Invasion of Time lost VHS, any particular personal favourite things you've discovered? Anything new that made you go, ooh?
I think it was, I mean, just going back to that thing with K-9 on Blue Peter, I just thought it was really nice seeing that material and seeing how the sort of programme goes outside the confines of it being Doctor Who onto something else, but how the production office was involved with that, and how Graham Williams wanted to make sure that what was being presented for K-9, because it was quite early on, it was only sort of 1 or 2 weeks after he'd actually been seen. In fact, I think it was after the first week, wasn't it, that they did the item. Bernard Wilkie didn't want it to happen, by the way. He thought it was far too soon for them to go around showing off K-9 too much. And Billy Baxter actually had to tell him, please, don't worry about it. We're not going to sort of be revealing any secrets or making fun of this. So we're not denigrating hard work. But just in general, I think it's ended up being a really interesting set of material, and it's just nice once again seeing how the program has developed. And it's been nice just sort of adding to the ever-growing pile of documentation that we've got on the sets. It's all swelling quite nicely. Do you want to hear a fascinating fact?
Always, Richard. Always. You know me.
All right. So our current total for the PDF archives over the 15 releases we've done so far is just over 58,800 pages. Now, it's interesting to put that into a little bit of context. And the context I'm going to use is the Encyclopedia Britannica. Do you remember going into libraries and they would always have a reference section of non-lendable stuff, and inevitably they would have a set of Encyclopedia Britannica. Now, Encyclopedia Britannica isn't actually made anymore. It's all gone online. The last time that Encyclopedia Britannica actually produced a hard copy set of encyclopedias was back in 2010. Oof. But that was their final time that they were going to do a hard copy set. And that was their 15th edition of the Encyclopedia Britannicas. And for that, if you wanted a full set, you'd pay $1,400, because despite the name, Encyclopedia Britannica is actually an American company, has been since the turn of the last century. And you would get the full 32-volume set like you saw in libraries, the huge set. But that 32-volume set would encompass 32,640 pages.
Wow.
So to put that into context, we're now talking about 15 releases in. We're now talking about just shy of 59,000 pages that we've done on the PDF archives. So that would be the equivalent of having your full 32-volume set of the Encyclopedia Britannica plus an extra, I think it is, 26 volumes on top of that, just to encompass all the stuff that we put in the PDF archive so far. So if you think back to 2010, when they did that last set of Encyclopedia Britannica, that would cost you $1,400. That was the equivalent of just over £900 at the time. Now that would, with inflation, that would be just over £1,330. And yet, all of this material is on the disc that people are buying. So when people say that, you know, that they have to fork out for an extra Blu-ray drive in order to access it, it just perhaps puts the cost in a little bit of context, and a little bit of context about what you're getting. Because some people also said online on occasion, oh, well, wouldn't it be easier to put this stuff into a book? Well, you could do, but you'd have to have a bigger set of shells than you do for your Doctor Who complete history, certainly by the time you finish. So, you know, it just gives a little bit of context to the size of the material that we're putting through, that, you know, that this is a huge, huge amount of documentation we've been putting onto these discs that people can access if they want. So, little fun fact for you.
That's a great fact on which to end. So, Richard, thank you so much. Now, I better let you get back to it, because there's no slacking when you're working these releases. Constant throughput of stuff. No feet up, no rest for the wicked.
No, not for me. I'm about 85% through the next one. So still a few little bits and pieces to do, and then it's cracking on with the one after that, straight on.
Brilliant stuff. Well, I shall let you get back to it, because I know that you're itching to go and find some more facts and pages for us.
Hurrah!
Thanks, Richard. Kelly. Cheers.
Cheers, mate. Bye-bye.
Thanks again, Richard. And hopefully we'll hear from Richard when the next set is on the way, whichever one it may be. But we'll discuss that next week as to which one we'd like to see next. So let's now hear a quick excerpt from Doctor Who and the Sunmakers.
Where are we?
We're still in the solar system.
The ninth planet.
Pluto's a lifeless rock.
It is like Earth.
It's all wrong. It shouldn't be like Earth.
We created a new environment for them here on Pluto.
Magnificent!
Six suns to be fueled and serviced.
The taxes, I can't pay the taxes.
Taxes are the primary considerations of...
These taxes, they are like sacrifices to tribal gods.
Paying taxes are more painful.
Then the people should rise up and slaughter their oppressors.
You spake. Within 10 seconds, everyone in the city will be dead. I shall have you steamed for your interference. This is the moment when I get a real feeling of job satisfaction.
Steevie, this is a story that Lou Jameson always quotes as being her favourite one from her time on Doctor Who. Is it one that's one of your favourite Leela stories?
I think so. It's a fun romp. It's you're not quite sure where it's going. It's very dystopian. lots of corridors, lots of tall corridors. There's an interesting design thing. I mean, the thing that I always remember is the man waiting, forgotten the character's name, for the little hatch to open to let him know that his father's passed. You could have done that in a, you know, in a 2 meter corridor type thing, but no, they went for something really tall and really way out, which kind of matched in with power station or wherever they were. And it just trots along from there. You've got to suspend a wee bit of disbelief. You know, it's different from a lot of Who stories. You don't know what's going on initially. The Doctor's investigating. There's lots of cliffhangers. There's lots of things that can go wrong. But I can understand why it's a favourite Leela episode. There's a lot of running around. There's a lot of good speeches for her. A wee bit similar to the speech that she did in the trailer for this season. You know, she got to do some good bits of acting, especially when they're captured and, you know, they're saying, oh, we're going to kill you, and she's telling them that she's going to take them with her. You know, they can try.
Yeah.
And it, you know, it again, it trots along. It says an awful lot about the 70s. Tax collection, cost of living, whatever we called it back then. It wasn't cost of living. Morals of today, income, expenses, taxes. So that goes over the kids' heads. The kids are just thinking, oh, what's going to happen? And Leela and the steamer, that's what it should have been called. That's quite horrific for,
yeah,
what, 5:30, 6 o'clock?
When Leela gets six. Steaming, yeah, definitely.
But, you know, but the description, you know, she's going to scream and she's going to have her flesh removed by this, that, and the other, and I've set up microphones to do. It's a good wee story. It's a bit weird in places, you know, especially when the gatherer, when he's...
With his hat.
With his hat, when he's tossed over the building, you actually think he's one of these characters that's going to survive a little bit and maybe be brought to task, but no. Angry mob.
So do you think that's a good thing, Stevie? Do you think that all villains should be tossed over the building?
No, absolutely not. Everyone should have their moment in court. But, you know, it's not often that happens in Doctor Who. You honestly thought, well, you know, he's the comedy character. They're not going to go. They have killed the comedy character.
Yep. Because for me, the biggest problem with the Sunmakers is the visuals, because I think it's a great script, but what lets it down is the fact it looks visually dated. I think the fact, considering it's meant to be Pluto, the skies are grey and it's not doesn't look particularly warm, considering the number of suns they've got around the planet. And I think there's an awful lot of corridors that the lighting on them is just... It just feels quite visually repetitive, and the colour scheme of it is quite... It feels 70s sort of mustards and browns and just not... particularly visually engaging, and I think that's what puts me off it.
It's so dystopian. We know it's filmed in factories in
Bristol, I think, if I remember.
Power stations and stuff. Mm-hmm. It's a tricky thing when you're filming as well, because mostly everything's in focus, I would say. So they're not putting the background out of focus. They don't have the time or the resources to do that. So everything, there's too much information there. I think that's part of the problem. They're limited with lighting and what they can do, and budget. Let's face it, budget. But I mean, I was having an interesting conversation with a pal the other day. It's when you start a show or a film or whatever you want to do, and the script says it's set here, this, you've got to make that decision. Well, how am I going to represent this? And someone's probably looking at this going, we can't. You know, we're just going to have to say this, and this. But I think the good thing is that it can be carried by the story and the actors and the action that's going on, because there's not really a dull moment. Mm-hmm. It could so easily have dragged.
Yeah. Henry Wolfe is very good as the collector.
Yes.
Very creepy. Just that sinister nasal voice and those eyelashes, those eyebrows are just very...
Well, again, we're going back to hair. Everyone loves hair in this season. But yeah, he's suitably creepy. But then you were just talking about, you know, previously in Fendahl, at least this one had some humour in it.
Very much so.
It had some lighter moments. It's very watchable. I wouldn't say it's my first go-to episode to say, you know, oh, I must watch. Again, The book expands on bits and pieces, and when you watch it, you're kind of doing that. If you've, I suppose for me, I read so many of these things first before I see them. Maybe the other way around, it wouldn't have mattered so much, but it matters to me when it's not quite what I was expecting. But again, great job, a great cast, lots of overacting, subtle acting, comedic acting. Yep. And Tom at some of his best, and of course K-9's first proper outing, where he saves the day noisily, but saves the day.
And of course, for trivia fans, to the best of my knowledge, this is the only complete Dudley Simpson score that still exists in Mark Ayres's archive.
Wow. Well, that's a bit sad.
It is, but the tapes were never really kept, so there's a bit of Android Invasion, a bit of Invasion of Time, and All of Sunmakers, to the best of my knowledge, is all that exists in their original form. So that's a sad thought, because there's so many great scores. But
yeah.
Oh, well. But hey, talking of great things, Stevie, why don't we hear now from Derek Handley, who has created the picture gallery on this? So he's brought together an awful lot of images, and he's going to tell us all about them for not just this story, but across the season.
Excellent.
Yeah, I'm Derek Handley. So for the Blu-ray collection releases, I do all the photo galleries, compile those, and also for the some of the releases, I do reconstructions as well, telesnap reconstructions of the missing episodes.
And you do them very well too, obviously. I have to say.
Thank you. Obviously not for 15, fortunately.
No, not for 15. Thankfully, everything is excellent and out there. So when did your interest in sort of, you know, photos and Doctor Who images begin?
Well, I guess I've always loved the photos, really. When I was a young fan, I'm too young to remember any of the 60s stories. And just that sort of fascination with all these things that, you know, had gone on before that I was unaware of. And I was always trying to collect photos and do as much research into those stories as I could, just because, you know, you read the target books and you want to see as much detail as you could. So I've always been, you know, trying to build up a collection and to see as many photos as I can. When I joined the DWAS, there were sort of photos offers on that you could buy, you know, little copies of BBC photos, and I built all of those. And then, you know, in the 80s, there was often prints and things on sale at conventions, things like that, and I bought loads of those. And it really just sort of stemmed from there, really. So, yeah, I've always had a passion for it. I think at one point I was buying sort of two copies of all the Doctor Who weeklies and Doctor Who monthlies and cutting one up with the pictures, so I'd have a little photo album of, you know, from each story. But, yeah. So it's always been a fascination for me.
Yeah, I completely get that. I was pretty much the same. I'd completely forgotten about DWAS selling those photos. Good gracious, I remember seeing them on CT all those years ago. Brilliant stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
So then I take it you were involved with the DVD collection with the photo galleries that appeared on there.
Yeah. So when the DVD started, Ralph Montague, who was a member of the restoration team, took it upon himself to start doing the photo galleries, and he soon realised that there was a lot of stuff that, although he had access to the BBC archives, that there was a lot of photos that had gone missing over the years, and certain stories that they were really short of. So he knew that I'd got a collection as well, and knew other people that had. And so he sort of reached out to me sort of for help on some of those galleries where there was particularly few pictures. I think Carnival of Monsters, for instance, springs to mind, where there was, I think he maybe only had sort of a dozen photos or something like that. And I was able to help him out with supplying some more for it. And so he then sort of contacted me quite regularly, sort of say, you know, what have we got for this one? And gradually I got more and more involved in the work to the point where we would get commissions for the next coming lot of DVDs, and we'd kind of take it in turns to do, you know, one gallery and then he'd do one. Over the years, I've sort of become, Rafe's kind of ducked down out of it, and I've taken over pretty much fully now. So yeah, it's sort of a gradual thing.
Yeah, I suppose Rafe's got other things to keep him busy these days, hasn't he, as well?
He has, yeah. Yeah. there.
His lordship, as he probably would hate to be called to that. Lovely.
I was down at Bewley yesterday, actually, and chatting to him, and they've now got, they've had Bessie there for a few years, so they've now got the Hoomobile, and they've just got Sarah Jane's car from K9 and Company. So, yeah, that was really exciting to see that. I didn't even know that still existed. So
neither did I. So I'd imagine then when the Blu-ray range began, say that slowly because it's very easy to trip over Blu-ray range, but there's a Blu-ray range, but I didn't, that it was a case of, okay, here we go, let's do these in the best possible presentation we possibly could.
Yeah, I think initially that the plan was just to use the carryover DVD versions. You know, it was sort of felt at the time that, okay, they were pretty good. We'll just use those and they'll just, you know, upscale them for the Blu-rays. But I sort of said to them, well, you know, a lot of the time now we've got better scans, but, you know, some of those were done well over 20 years ago and the scanning technology's improved a lot. And we've got access to a wider range, a much wider range of photos now than we had then. You know, they're one of the things that can truly be HD. You know, obviously most of the actual episodes are just upscaled from video so that they look great. But these, you know, you've got an original 35mm or a medium format slide or something, and, you know, they can be absolutely massive. And so you really can get good results from them. And it's certainly proved worth, I think, rescanning a lot of the stuff we had and recompiling these galleries.
Having worked in newspapers and magazines for a number of years, I'm always curious to know what sort of DPI you're working at when you're scanning these.
So mostly that they've been scanned at 3,200 DPI. More recently, I'm doing them at 4,800.
Wow.
So and we have scanned most things now that are in the BBC library.
That's impressive. Wow. So let's have a chat about season 15 in particular and going through. So how well is it represented in the archives photographically?
Those sort of mid-Tom Baker years, unfortunately, they're not terribly well represented. And this season in particular, some stories, there's very, very few pictures. Horror Fang Rock and Sunmakers in particular. I think for Sunmakers, that there was one black and white publicity shot that was selected. And there's an alternate frame on that negative, but black and white wise, that's all that existed. So unfortunately, there's a little bit more in the color, but again, not a lot. The archives, when they took photos, I mean, there were several different departments that were taking pictures. So there was the photographer signed by to take the BBC publicity photos. There were sometimes Radio Times photographers, and quite often there would be someone from the design department sent along that would take pictures mostly of the sets, which gave sort of continuity for when they had to maybe restage a set or just as reference for how the sets were constructed and what they looked like. And sometimes those were taken during rehearsals as well. So you do get actors on set in some of them, sometimes not in the full costumes or makeup or whatever. Sometimes they're almost indistinguishable from the publicity photos. So there's several different sources. And then, you know, certainly for some of the later stories, you do get fans and other people that were allowed in studio and sometimes took some photos there as well. But, you know, the majority of the ones that we have access to are either sort of the BBC publicity design or Radio Times. For that season, there's almost nothing from Radio Times, though. Whether it wasn't taken or just not kept, we're not sure. Horror Fang Rock in particular, I think because that was done, filmed in Birmingham and not in London, I think that meant that there was a lot of the regular photographers weren't in that location, so just didn't get any pictures taken. There's certainly, there's no colour design shots. There's a handful of black and white prints that we've got access to. And relatively few colour and black and white publicity shots. Nothing from Radio Times. So, you know, that was one particularly we really did struggle with.
That's amazing. Because I know that, you know, the likes of the Daily Mirror, you know, when it came to like the press conference for like launching K9 with Tom and Louise, and there must be about 70, 80 odd shots that were taken at the time. And was there much in the way of that there for you guys?
Yeah, so the photo calls, generally there's a reasonable selection, you know, black and white and sometimes quite a handful of colour as well. But the story-specific stuff is more difficult because that was generally just the BBC staff photographers that had access to that. So, yeah, there was obviously there was a rooftop photo call on top of, I think it's a TV centre canteen or something like that, with Tom and Louise, and they had K9 there. So there is quite a few press photos, and there are BBC publicity photos from that. And then towards the end of the season, there was another photo call outside the American Embassy with Tom and an array of different creatures, including the new Sontarans. And again, there are some, I think just black and white actually, but there are some shots from that we've been able to use. On Invisible Enemy, introducing K9, that there was, again, a fair bit of publicity for that, and including things like Blue Peter. K9 was on Blue Peter, and we've got a black and white film taken in the studio of K9 with John Noakes. And so we've used some of those, and there's a few colour shots in there as well. So hopefully they haven't been seen before.
Excellent. I do quite like seeing these unseen ones, as I'm sure you do. Talking of unseen images, of course, Richard Bignell uncovered some slides. So that must have been quite exciting for you to get these and then work on them. I mean, what sort of resolution can you get from a slide compared with a photographic print or a negative?
Pretty good. I mean, this bonus of having the original slides or negatives, that you can usually get a lot more detail out of them than you can a print. You know, if you've got a print, you're limited to the contrast levels that was printed at, and quite often that the dark areas are a bit crushed and the white areas are a bit bleached out, and you know, it looks okay, but there's no way that near the amount of detail that you can get on a good negative or an original slide scan. So we're lucky that so many of the originals do exist. But yeah, I think that at 64,000 or 6,400 DPI, you know, we do get pretty good quality scans. So they're certainly weighing above what we need for Blu-ray. But yeah, they're probably around about 6,000 pixels wide, something like that. So they do look stunning most of the time. Yeah.
Oh, can't wait to see these now. Really can't wait. But I suppose that's the other thing, is that you will get the odd surprise now and again when people turn up with their own private images that they took. I suppose you might find the odd cast member having taken something and the likes, and then give you wee surprises here and there.
Yeah, no, it's lovely when we do find this sort of thing. And Richard's very good at tracking down a lot of the, you know, the behind-the-scenes people that have worked on the show and did maybe have their own features. People like Sophie Aldred's been great when we did season 26. You know, she had quite a few films that she lent me the negatives and things like that. And, other fans of, certainly during the McCoy era, Richard himself had taken photos in the studio, and they kindly lent me the negatives where they still can find them, and we were able to scan those. But sadly, nothing quite that exciting for season 15. But one thing that one extra lot of pictures we did get, though, was from Matt Irvin, particularly for Invisible Enemy again. So he did all the model shots for that, and he took quite a few 35mm slides. So he lent me those, all the originals of those. He also had quite a few bits of the actual film trims, which he'd retained. So these were basically in a 35mm slide mount, with two frames of the actual film. They had degraded a little bit in terms of the colours, that they'd gone terribly pink over the years, most of those frames. But, you know, in Photoshop, we were able to pretty much correct the colours back to what they should be, hopefully. And we've used quite a few of those now on the gallery, so you'll be able to see those.
I suppose that's the thing, that it's the gift that never seems to stop giving, just sort of finding all these gems and just thinking what is going to show up next, because there always seems to be something being found. I know that, you know, from personal experience, stuff showing up in mirror pics when, you know, I thought everything had been extensively found in 2013, and tons of stuff showing up since then. So it's always good to see.
Yeah. Well, there was exciting stuff that did turn up last year, but unfortunately, a lot of it were the seasons that we'd already released on Blu-ray, which was quite frustrating. But there is some stuff that will come into use in some future ones as well. So this was a lot of stuff from the Radio Times photographer Don Smith. Sadly, he passed away a couple of years ago, and I knew him fairly well. I'd often asked him, have you got any negatives at home? And he says, oh, if I'd kept everything, you know, I'd have a house full of stuff. And it turned out he did have a house full of stuff. It was absolutely packed with stuff that he never threw away. So fortunately, we were able to get in after he died. And he had sort of left he'd said to one of the guys that works at Radio Times, that, you know, please go through the house and reclaim what you can. I think there was about 40 boxes full of negatives, films, prints, all sorts of things that was retrieved from his house in the end. Only a fraction of Doctor Who, unfortunately, but there was literally tens of thousands of pictures and negatives that we've got now. I had 8 boxes of those here that I was helping to sort through, because many of them were just, there was one box that was literally just full of little bits of 35mm black and white negative, just cut up into 2 or 3 frames sometimes, and just all mixed up in a big box. I'm still trying to work out what some of those are, because nothing's labelled. There were sometimes a whole folder full of from particular series that was labelled, but a lot of the stuff was just loose negatives or stuff in a folder or prints. And there's a team have been spending the last year or so trying to identify and catalogue it all and get it refiled back at Radio Times. But there has been some quite exciting Doctor Who stuff in there. So, brilliant. And some negatives that, you know, from the 60s that we got prints of and we got contact sheets, but then the original negatives have gone missing, and now most of those have turned up, I'm glad to say. So
that's fantastic news. I'd assume then that, because I always wondered what the relationship was with the Radio Times, you know, given that it was no longer part of the BBC, having been sold off privately.
Yeah, it's a complex one. So obviously when we started doing the DVDs, Radio Times was wholly owned by the BBC. And then I think it was around about 2009, 2010 that they split off and are now owned by Immediate Media. So certainly anything past that point is not a BBC copyright. Before that, it's such a difficult area. All the staff at that point were BBC staff, although they were assigned to Radio Times. So we believe that it does come under still BBC copyright, although those are mostly now back at the Radio Times offices. A lot of the Radio Times photos had been amalgamated into the BBC photo library. And over the last few years, that's gradually been sifted through, and most of the Radio Times stuff has now been separated out and sent back to Radio Times. But quite often it's very difficult to tell what is what, because, you know, they're not necessarily labelled as such. And it's just kind of trying to work out who took them, when they were taken, and if we can sort of see if there's something in Radio Times that matches up with that or not. But it's a little bit of a tricky situation.
Yeah, I don't envy that one at all. Leave it to the lawyers.
But I think that generally, you know, the Radio Times are quite happy for us to use these. And, you know, they use a lot of BBC copyrights pictures as well. So, yeah.
Everyone's a winner.
Hopefully.
Because just when you mentioned Don Smith's work, because that would explain where quite a lot of these pictures that showed up on the Radio Times website last year had come from that we hadn't seen before.
Yeah. Yeah. Fantastic. Especially exciting that there was about 2 films from Mind of Evil. Large medium format black and white negs, and probably the best pictures I've ever seen of Roger Delgado. Just absolutely stunning. And Patrick Malkin has put a good selection of those up on the Radio Times website. If you haven't seen those, then do check it out.
Fantastic. Well, that's been brilliant. Thank you, Derek. Really, really enjoyed that, getting a wee insight into how these things come together, because there's a hell of a lot of work goes into them. So nice to let you know that they are appreciated.
Thank you.
But hopefully we'll speak again soon when there's some more images on the way to be seen and enjoyed. But no, thank you once again for your time, Derek.
That's okay. Good to speak to you. Thanks.
Big thanks to Derek joining us here on The Power of Three for the first time. And of course to Richard, who is an old seasoned pro at this game and a friend of the podcast, as we like to say. I don't particularly like to say it because I hate it. It makes me sound like I'm on crap local radio stuff. Hey, good friend of the show. But, oh well, I'll go with the flow. Others say it, so I might as well. So
it's better than saying an enemy of the podcast.
Oh, that's true. Well, do we have any enemies? I'm sure we do. We just can't mention them.
No, let's not mention them because they're enemies of the podcast, and that would be unfair.
Exactly. But we do have a lot of podcast pals as well. So, yeah. Now, Steevie, talking of pals, why don't we hear from a couple of our pals to hear their thoughts on Image of the Fendahl and the Sunmakers? First of all, we'll hear from Dr. John Bollan, and then from the podcast's founding father, Tom Harris.
Then we have Image of the Fendahl. This, for me, is one of my favourite stories of all time. And I have a very complex relationship with this story because very inconsiderately, my dad died between episodes 2 and 3. That sounds terrible saying that aloud. I'll get a cuff around the ear from my family if they listen to this. So the first two episodes of this, again, are very vivid for me. The last two, not so much. But I remember watching the first couple of episodes, especially the first one, and being really creeped out by it, because this was broadcast in November 1977. So it was cold and dark, and it seemed to fit very much with these kind of nighttime scenes, the threat of this creeping menace that you can't see at this point. I just thought, well, this was great, you know, and it really kind of seemed to tie in with what we kids were playing at outside. We used to always play Doctor Who and run about and do stuff like that. So, yeah, this was very much a kind of a chiming in with that. I just loved and was creeped out by the idea of not being able to move, not being able to get away. It's that classic night terror feeling, isn't it, when you're in this dream and you can't move. So I thought that was great. But I loved the rest of the story. I just thought it was good. I believed the banter between the researchers, even though the Fendaline themselves are a little bit ropey. I thought the full scale model worked really well. You know, as a kid, I was quite creeped out by that. But I just thought, yeah, a bit like Horrifying Rock, a really good ensemble of a cast having fun with a creepy skull. Although a lot of it is kind of tongue-in-cheek, the end of it is quite dark as well. When Stiles asks for the gun and, you know, the doctor gives it to him, and then it becomes apparent that he means to use it on himself. You know, that takes us in a different kind of place. It's very much consistent, I suppose, with Chris Boucher's grittier style of writing. Yeah, again, for me, I would be giving Image of the Fendahl 10 out of 10. Just love it. Sunmakers, well, this is one that I remember very little of, really, the first time around. I didn't really get into this story. I think the fact that it was very much about humour, it was very much a kind of a pastiche, very much a kind of a commentary on, well, I don't know if the urban myth is true, that it was Robert Holmes signing off about his relationship with Inland Revenue, but or HMRC or whoever. But there were no monsters in it, you know. The monster was the system. The monster was the fiscal monster. So that for me as a kid just meant this kind of went, you know, over my head. And I've only really come to appreciate it as an adult who, you know, would heartily sympathise with Robert Holmes in his fight against the man, against the corporation. Yeah, but a witty classic, shall we say? So I would give it a 6 out of 10 for me.
Then Image of the Fendahl.
Yeah, well, I said that it stopped scaring me, but I remember watching Image of the Fendahl and thinking, this is proper scary stuff.
Yeah, very Hammer Horror. I'm
really pleased with it. I thought that it's probably my favourite from that season, because I just thought, you know, there's some great imagery in this. There was some really genuine scares. Yeah, slightly ropey special effects and model work, but it was actually quite impressive at the same time. So, yeah, I really enjoyed that one.
Yeah, and Wanda Ventham just looks glorious as well. So,
yeah.
The Sunmakers. It looks a bit cheap.
It does, you know.
But it's a great script.
It's a brilliant script. And, it, you know, I guess the producers must have thought, I mean, of course, it's set in Pluto. So, of course, it's not going to be sunny. But, I mean, they weren't really going for realism because, you know, if it was set in Pluto, it would be complete blackness. And I just thought, I bet they wished for sunny weather when they filmed this, and it's so dull and overcast and miserable looking, but it's great. And especially at the end when the guy gets chucked off the roof of the building, that's really, really pretty grim, quite violent actually, but funny as well. Very black humour. I thought it was a great show.
Thank you for sharing your thoughts on Image of the Fendahl and the Sunmakers. But Stevie, would you like to come back next week and discuss the final two stories of the season?
I would love to come back next week and discuss the final two. That's hard to believe that we are discussing the final two.
I know. It's flying isn't by.
Isn't it funny, though? Well, not funny. I mean, for 25 minuters and four each and blah, blah, blah. But these seasons seem to go on forever.
They do.
And but in a good way. I don't mean in a bad way. But over the years, it's just decreased and decreased and decreased. And, okay, I think it's better to have 50-minute, 55-minute episodes per story instead of 25, because there's an awful lot of repeating in a 25. That's the other thing I would say about this. There's an awful lot of repeating.
Yeah. But would you say there's an awful lot of repeating?
I would say there's an awful lot of repeating. The thing about Doctor Who at that point is that you started watching and it seemed to, whenever it was on, it seemed to go on forever in a good way. And now, whether it's because we're older or the format, you're watching it and before you know it, you're at the end. And that has an effect on how you think about it and how you look at it and how kids look at it, especially on demand. If they don't get it while it's live and then they catch up with it one Saturday, all eight episodes, it's not the same.
Yeah, binging it, box setting it, to use that term.
But no time to digest.
Yeah.
And that's the thing about all these episodes. On a good cliffhanger, say Fang Rock, you had an entire week to worry and discuss with your pals of what's going to happen, this, that, and the other. And that's a change in broadcast. But it has an effect on Doctor Who. It has an effect on how we look at things like this now, because I watched these episodes one after another.
Interesting. It's definitely I think that's a discussion for another day, but to sort of, you know, our consumption of the show and how it's changed over the years and how we look at it. So yeah, I think we'll definitely have to revisit that in the very near future. But Stevie.
Kenny, I was thinking, as I do, I was driving along and I was thinking, oh, I'm doing a podcast with Kenny. And I was thinking of all the questions that I could possibly ask you.
Mm-hmm.
And I was going to say, what Pantone is the TARDIS? No, no. if you had to say, I don't know, record a podcast more or less every week and you were at episode 200 and whatever, and you were at episode 200 and whatever, what song do you think you might possibly play out with?
Well, I would consider what had been discussed, for example, if there was a story that was perhaps related to an image, you know, it could have been like Picture of You from Boyzone, but I hate them, so there's no chance that's getting played. And then thought something's related to like the Sunmakers, and you think when they were doing the Sunmakers, obviously they were under quite a lot of pressure as the budget is getting squeezed and squeezed and squeezed, and they'd be feeling the pressure. And
would they be under pressure, Kenny?
They would be under pressure, but you'd almost think, you know, like they'd be screaming. So I'm reminded of a 1995 hit that I absolutely loved because I used to listen to this on repeat in the jukebox in the banks of Uri Pub in Inverurie. We are going with Sunscreen and Pressure Us. Let's get some dance music on. Hit it, guys. We'll see you next week.
I'm going to do my taxes. Goodbye.